conflict and dissension in the world. But what this show is about is what's being done to transform the black community. Thus, the show taken from the title of my book, Seeing Heaven in the Face of Black Men. If you're interested in that book, you can go to heaveninthefaceofblackmen.com. That's heaveninthefaceofblackmen.com. What the show is about and what this book is about, it's about rewriting the negative narrative that exists in our society about black folks. And as subconsciously, we take on as our own narrative and we treat each other as such. So we're going to try to rewrite our story, seeing the nobility, the power, and the beauty in ourselves, and translating that into how we relate to, communicate, interact with each other, and respond to each other. We want to be acting and not reacting, choosing our responses based on our nobility. I always say choosing our responses based on our nobility is a healthy place to be. So I try to interview people who are in the process of transforming themselves and transforming their communities. And today is no exception. I should say tonight, because it's after 6 o'clock. I want to dedicate this show to my mother. My mother, Mildred Ewing, who passed away 1 year ago this weekend, October 23rd. She was the one who really, I think her and my dad gave us our sense of values. She gave us our sense of drive. And I'm thinking a lot about her these days. So Mildred Ewing, in the next world, I hope you hear me. So I also want to say that I started doing this show about 6 months ago, and Reggie Gaskins was talking to me about it, and I was quite nervous about doing it, and I thought, you know, I've never done anything like this. You know, what am I going to have to say? And he kept telling me, Todd, you've got something to say. You can try it. And so I appreciate Reggie Gaskins for introducing me to this show and encouraging me to be part of this show, and it's been really a wonderful experience. I've grown. I've developed, I think I've gotten just a tad better in what I'm doing. But this will have to be my last show because I've got to move on to some other things. And I want to shout out to Reggie. He just walked in the door and tell him how much I appreciate the fact that he talked me into it, because I was running the other way. And his brother, he sat down and he was in my ear for about 45 minutes, asked me, what was the matter with me? What's wrong with you? He said. And I went home and I said, okay, he's got a point. So shout out to Reggie. Also, I want to mention, and I talked about this in the last show, that the Museum of African American History and Culture opened on September 24th. I went on September 26th for the first time. And I went with my son-in-law and my two granddaughters, and it was a beautiful experience. It was powerful, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that experience. But I'm hearing my voice recorded now. That's interesting. I hear my voice recorded through here. I like that. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about the experience of going to the African American History and Culture Museum, because it was so powerful, and I'm going to just share a little blog that I wrote about it. And this last Saturday, I went for a second time. So the first time I went to the fourth and the third floor. The fourth and the third floor are unique in the fact that they talk about the visual arts, they talk about music, they talk about all the accomplishments that black people have made. And the first floor, there's actually three floors that really talk about the history, that rough history, the slavery, the pain, the suffering. You know, that's a hard place to go. And so the first time I went to the museum, I didn't go to that. I couldn't handle it. There's too many things going on in society. There's too many shootings of black men. There's too much pain already. And I didn't need to go to another place where there was a lot of pain. So I avoided the first floor the first time around and just went to the fourth and third floor. But this time I went to the first floor, and I went through that experience of seeing slavery, seeing Reconstruction, and seeing all the challenges and the triumphs of that time period. And I was ready for it this time. But I want to just share with you what I wrote about this, and that I asked my guests to bear with me, because I told them to act like they're really interested in what I'm saying, you know, to like shake their head like I'm saying something real profound, right? But I didn't want to share this because I was really moved. Here's what President Obama said about black people. He said, we're not a burden on America or a stain on America or an object of pity or charity. We are America. And he's talking about African Americans. It affirms that all of us are American, that African American history is not somehow separate from our larger American story. It's not the underside of American history. So I want to thank President for saying that so clearly. So it's difficult to put into words, and this is what I wrote, what it felt like, and I say this past Monday, because I wrote this after the first time I went, going to the newly opened Museum of African American History and Culture. And that's why I hadn't written about it. And I already said that I went to the first, I was supposed to start on the first floor. You know, what happened was the first floor was crowded, and so that was one of my excuses not to go to the first floor the first time around, because it was packed. And I said here, I really was not in the mood for the painful reminders of what that first floor had to offer. There's too much pain for me right now in the current reality. And I said to myself, another day, another time. But the fourth floor had the music, the visual arts, poetry, and more. I saw the history of heaven in so many black faces. The energy, the vibrancy, the power grabbed me and wouldn't let go. I couldn't stop smiling. I was walking around smiling. Everybody was walking around those floors, and they couldn't stop smiling. And I felt that deep, deep pride and gratitude for all that we've accomplished. And I was thinking of Langston Hughes' poem that ends, "I too am America." I was thinking of the pain. I was thinking of the possibilities. But I strongly felt the enduring image that came to my head was something I'd heard so many times, and that was the phoenix rising from the ashes on the National Mall. That was the image I had, like a phoenix rising from the ashes on the National Mall in the heart of the Capitol. But it was not rising, it was bursting onto the mall from an oppressive past. And it was not a phoenix, it was black people, past and present as the collective, emerging as one voice to express, as John Hope Franklin said, and John Lewis repeated at the opening ceremony, to express the unvarnished truth. And then I heard the voice in my head of Nina Simone, who in one of her songs kept saying over and over again, power, power, power. And finally, I thought and felt what Baha'u'llah, the prophet founder of the Baha'i faith, said about black people. He compared black people to the pupil of the eye. He said, in this black pupil is seen the reflection of that which is before it, and through it the light of the spirit shineth forth. I want to say that again. Baha'u'llah, the prophet founder of the Baha'i faith, compared black people to the pupil of the eye. He said, in this black pupil is seen the reflection of that which is before it, and through it the light of the spirit shineth forth. The light of the spirit is on full display in the Museum of African American History and Culture on the National Mall. There is something profound and spiritually significant about the opening of this museum at this time in history. It can be a source of healing for our country if we let it, if we absorb it and feel its meaning and take it for the truth it represents. I pray it becomes so. I pray the truth will set us free. So that was what I felt about that experience of going to that museum. Thank you for listening, and thank you even for acting interested. I really appreciate that. So welcome to our show. I want to welcome all of our guests. We've got, where's Brianna? We've got Brianna here. We've got Brianna's mother, Miss Ebony Lockhart. We've got Rashad, who's going to be calling in on the phone, I hope, in a minute. We've got Maddie. We've got Crystal. And over there, where you can't see her, we've got Bianca. So Bianca will come and say something to us in a little bit. I want to thank you all for being a part of the show, being willing to come here and talk to us today. And as you know, the title of the show, which I mentioned several times, is See the Heaven in Every Black Face. And it's really about the transformation, you know, of the black community. And so much of that transformation has to come about how we see ourselves first. Do we see heaven in our own faces? Is that the image when we think about ourselves, when we think about black people? Are we thinking about heaven in our face, or are we thinking about something else? Do we have that negative narrative going around in our head, what it says about black people in society? Or do we see the beauty and the strength and the honor and the dignity? Is that what we're seeing when we look at our black brothers and sisters? If it's not what we're seeing, then we have to work on ourselves and figure out how we can see heaven in our own faces so we can see it in the faces of other black folks. And so when you hear that expression, see heaven in every black face, how does that strike you? And what would you be looking for if you were looking for heaven in every black face? And anybody can respond to this. I don't want everybody to respond to it, but I just want a couple of comments about that. What would you be looking for if you were seeing heaven in every black face? Don't be shy. What does heaven mean to you? What do you think about when you think about heaven?
Peace.
Mm-hmm. What else? What do you think about when you think about heaven?
I think of light and kindness, a kind of joy that is sometimes hard to describe, but that you just really feel.
Energy, mm-hmm. That energy, peace, joy. And that's what we want to see. And, you know, sometimes, you know, this is people, when I say see the heaven in every black face, they kind of take that lightly. But I can tell you, if we start to look for that in each other, look at a person the way they could be and they become what they should be. That's the idea. So sometimes we're walking down the street, and I can tell you this, most everybody nowadays walking down the street is going through something. They may have a scowl on their face, they might look like they're having a rough time, they may even cuss you out, but you need to see heaven in that face when that's happening, because they may need that smile, they may need that person to be kind to them. And if you're not going to be kind to them if you don't see heaven in their face. So I encourage that. I'm making that strong pitch to see heaven in every black face. So this show is about transform ourselves, transform our communities, claim our nobility. So that's what these guests are about. And so I'm going to just start in slowly, and I'm going to say, you know, you all are part of a youth mentorship program, and it's called the Junior Youth Spiritual Empowerment Program. One of your brochures, it says this. It says this program, speaking of the Junior Youth Spiritual Empowerment Program, has great potential carrying out acts of service that lead towards social change in their neighborhoods and communities. And it goes on to say, it also talks about facilitating a process for them to understand the constructive and destructive forces at work in society, and to help them understand how that all can influence their thoughts and actions. Now that sounds pretty powerful. So Crystal and Maddie, I know you are coordinators of this program. And so talk about, what is the Spiritual Youth Junior, the Spiritual Empowerment Program, Junior Youth Spiritual Empowerment Program. What is it? Say that three times fast.
So the Junior Youth Empowerment Program, it's a community-based program that is really focused on the young people in a community being at the forefront of social change, transformation, of building on the strengths of their community and addressing any challenges. So it's really, all those things you read from the brochure are part of the process, really, of the 11, 12, 13, 14-year-olds within a neighborhood or school, apartment complex, seeing themselves as able to affect change around them.
Okay, well, that's huge. And you said, and I'm glad you said it this way, because a lot of times people look at certain communities as just having challenges, but you said looking at the strengths and building on those strengths and addressing the challenges through those strengths. And I think that's the spirit, the attitude. That is an empowering attitude. And so your roles as, what do you do as coordinators? You're both coordinators. What do you do as coordinators?
Well, I specifically work with coordinating the trainings for high schoolers or youth who are interested in becoming what we call animators of the Junior Youth Program, so kind of like mentors. That's my role.
Talk a little bit more about that. What does that consist of? I mean, really, you're talking about animators. We want to talk about what animators do, but the audience needs to have a little bit more detail about what that's about.
About an animator?
Or what they study, what are they studying?
Oh, yeah, sure. So there's a series or a sequence of courses or books. So these courses really involve, they're for anyone who wants to become involved in their community. So it's not just for people that are interested in becoming mentors for the Junior Youth Program, but also it's part of a larger community building process that has children's classes, devotionals that can be done also. And so these courses are really focused on how we can improve ourselves, but also how we can improve our community. So reading through quotations from the Baha'i Faith and seeing how they can be applied to our own lives and to whatever service that we may choose to undertake in our communities, which one of them being an animator of the Junior Youth Program.
Animator, and so that term, animator, that's not a common term. That's not a term you hear a lot. And so just, you know, we use the term mentor. A lot of people are used to that term. So when you're saying an animator, what, just kind of, again, clarify why that term, what that means in terms of the person who mentors.
So the program uses the term animator because usually when people hear animator, they think of drawing and cartoons.
Animation, right?
But it's not that different in concept, because the idea is that the animator is able to help bring the group of middle schoolers, kind of not bring them to life because already the middle schoolers have so much energy, but really direct that energy towards service to their communities, towards good deeds. And so it's not just mentoring, because the animators are not telling the middle schoolers what to do or that they should think about this or you guys have to do this today. But really, the animator, they support the middle schoolers and they channel their energy. They help to kind of direct their energy towards good deeds, towards helping their communities.
I can't believe that that age group would need any direction. Okay, Brianna, I'm going to put you on the spot for a minute. You are, quote, one of the junior youth, and I guess that's the 11 to 14-year-old. How old are you?
13.
So you're kind of right there, coming near the end of that junior youth. Let me just ask you, just what attracted you initially to the junior youth program?
Initially, I wanted to be in a program that didn't just help a specific group of people, but it helped everyone in general. So that's basically
the question. And so when you say it helps everybody, you're talking about like who?
I feel like a community is a place where everyone is looked after or looked presented for. So I feel like as far as this group, we try to do things that helps everyone in the community, not just targeting a group of people. So it can help make everyone's lives a little bit better.
That's great. Quite a vision for the whole community, right? And you're the mother.
Yes. You know, proud at that.
Proud mother. Yeah. And so, you know, again, you obviously care about your child, and I know that you're very attuned to what she would get involved in. So what attracted you to this program? What made you comfortable having your child in the Junior Youth Spiritual Empowerment Program?
Initially, the name and the fact that youth and empowerment just got me right there because, of course, self-explanatory, that's where you want the youth to be intact and aware of their surroundings, the things that's going on, their contribution that they will have upon becoming adults, and the role that they'll play with everyone else as a team in this thing called society. And the spirituality portion was important to me because it wasn't like a forced spirituality or the vision of spirituality. It was just the cohesiveness of spirituality and youth and empowerment. I felt that was pretty cool and positive.
That's very profound. And I think the program for me, I know a couple programs that I'm aware of that really deal with the spiritual components. Some people deal with the arts components and other components, but there's only a couple that I know that deal with the spiritual component, and that can be tricky. And, you know, you mentioned, Crystal, you mentioned that you read sometimes in these classes quotes from the Baha'i teachings or the Baha'i faith. And I'm guessing that a lot of people don't know what that is. And if you could give just kind of a brief overview so they know when you say Baha'i what that means, or one of you. They're both of you.
Well, the Baha'i Faith is a world religion founded by Baha'u'llah, who Todd mentioned earlier. And the purpose is to unite all of mankind, no matter your religion, your race, gender. That's pretty much a general brief statement.
And so in saying that, and I happen to be a member of the Baha'i Faith too, and so I think one of the things that strikes me about it is the unity of the religions, which is so important. Mm-hmm. The belief in the unity of the religions, there's only one God. And if there's only one God, there must be a unity between the religions. It doesn't make sense for the religions to be in competition with one another. Mm-hmm. And so I think for me, the vision of the Baha'i Faith is just that. It can bring religions together because we see them as chapters in the same book of God's one religion. And that's a beautiful way to say that. And I'm bringing this up because, you know, for a mother or a father to say, to trust their child to some people, maybe you haven't heard of the Baha'i Faith, but to trust their child because you feel somehow that it's okay, that nothing's going to be forced on them, you're not going to try to convert them, but you're just going to use kind of spiritual principles to guide them, you know. And how did you gain that kind of trust? Because religion is sensitive.
The fact the word itself wasn't used, because a lot of power is in words, but the fact that spirituality to me is more it's a broader positivity than a narrow vagueness per se. Yeah, yeah. So I just thought it would be interesting to, or that it was incorporated. I was just unfamiliar with it, as you stated.
Right.
I just found that it should be interesting to kind of get to learn. I trusted. I trusted her to get as much out of it as possible,
right.
And we kind of just took it step by step with that. But
yeah.
I was on board. Everything has gone well thus far. So,
and trust is a huge word. I mean, I think the relationship building that goes on in this process is part of the profound part of community building. That we're building relationships. We're building relationships across race and class and culture and everything, and building that kind of trust. And so I know that Bianca over there. If she can walk over here just for a second. Now, Brianna, how long have you been in the program?
This is my second year.
Your second year. Oh, powerful. And Bianca, just if you get close to the microphone, I know I'm just going to ask you the question. You're just starting, right, with the program?
Yes.
So I just want to ask you the same question I asked Brianna. What attracted, what made you want to be a part of this?
I wanted to be a part of this program because I wanted to help the environment.
The environment, that's beautiful. You mean the environment of the neighborhood or the environment of the whole world? Now that's deep. That's a good vision to help the whole world. Yeah, no, that's powerful. And what do you both hope to gain from this program? What are your wish, hopes, and desires to gain from this program?
To make the world a better place.
I like that.
I want to gain a sense of how everyone feels in the same community, but as different people or different races or religions or cultures, to see how the different lifestyles, how they change the meaning of life to different people.
I like that. You know, I mean, you're talking about some profound, for a 13-year-old, and how old are you?
11.
11-year-old wanting to change the world and wanting to change the neighborhood and having that vision already, that, in my view, is spiritual empowerment. To not just be thinking about yourself, to not just be thinking about, you know, I'm not going to go on into that, but I saw somebody with a very expensive pair of tennis shoes the other day, and I thought to myself, you know, that's okay, but I wonder where that focus is. You know, I'm wondering if that's the best place to be spending your energy. And I think, you know, thinking about what the world is, thinking about what you can do in the world, I think is very powerful. So I know we're supposed to have a young man calling in. And do you know what's happening with Rashad at all? Is the phone hooked up? Phone's hooked up?
The phone's hooked up.
And so...
Text him, tell him to call in.
I texted him, so I'm waiting.
So, okay.
We can also call him from here, so if you want to do that as well.
Oh, okay.
Would you call him on that line? Is that how that works? Okay, so while we're waiting and trying to get a hold of Rashad's a young man who's been in the program for how long?
He joined last year.
Okay, so he's been in for a year, and he's what you call an animator, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I wanted to talk to him about that. He's a young black man.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, with all the things that are going on in the community with young black men, I think it's fitting that hopefully we're able to hear from him. Are we going to try to call him, or how are we going to do this?
Yeah, we can. I think that would be good.
So, and while we're trying to do it, are you going to...
Should I go over there?
I'll help you write down.
Okay, so somebody was talking about the challenges, the strengths of the neighborhood. Where do you all, what neighborhood do you all live in?
We reside in Southwest.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so the junior youth program takes place there?
No, actually it takes place in Columbia Heights.
Okay.
Which is where they attend school.
Ah, okay. And so, you know, you talked about the challenges. We mentioned the challenges. We mentioned the strength. What are some of the challenges in these communities that you, as you all see it? What are the challenges? Because, you know, this is what we're trying to address. So what are some of the challenges? Because the idea is how does this program help to address some of those challenges, right? What do you see as some of the challenges in Columbia Heights and or your neighborhood?
Mostly racial profiling or shaming. Or not even that, it's just some people don't understand the different ways of life, and they don't know how to communicate that.
So that's one problem, right? Okay. Anybody else? What do you see as the challenges in the neighborhood? You've been working in some of the neighborhoods for a while. What are you seeing? And and what are you seeing as you've been around here a while, in and out of the area?
Yeah, all over the DMV, basically.
All over the DMV. So
the
you've got
East
a
coast in general. So yeah.
So what are some of the challenges you're seeing?
I see things visually changing before spiritually changing, basically. So like if 1 minute one building is here and the next minute something, another building that brings a different group of people are there, and you feel like that is being compromised by your personal culture or perception, sometimes it just creates like a hostility that's unnecessary, and it's like misdirected. It's just things happen faster than the human mind can interpret it. So I really just think it's like a disconnect with time almost, more than anything. Like everything is happening so fast, everyone's like, okay, you know, distrusting.
Now, and when you're saying that, are you kind of talking about gentrification? Are you talking about that kind of change, or what kind of change?
Gentrification, also the societal changes that come along with gentrification, and the fact that the future is seeing this, and they may not have the tools to understand what it means and where they fit into it. Those type of differences.
And you know, just, and you two have been a part of the Junior Youth Program for how long now?
So I've been working with it for the past year, but when I was in high school, I was an animator for the program, so like 7 years ago.
And so, you know, they're talking about gentrification, you're talking about a little bit about gentrification. We know in D.C. that's a huge issue, and it's something that affects probably every level of community, adults, youth, and children. And how do you see this Junior Youth Program kind of on whatever level helping with that, helping with some of the attitudes, some of the hostility that you were talking about, and some of the challenges? Is there a role that the Junior Youth Program you see it playing?
Yeah, I think there are maybe a couple, I mean, there are many ways that the program addresses this challenge of gentrification and how people view one another in a community. I think one is it simply brings more people together, and we've found, particularly Columbia Heights, where many of our junior youth groups in DC are, is very gentrified and quickly gentrifying. And so just bringing more people together who become friends, people who would see themselves as on this side of the gentrification line, on that side, they probably did this, I bet they're like that. And so it's very easy to have these ideas of other people, just like what Brianna was saying, in our heads. And so I think this program has a great power to it in that it crosses all age lines, all class lines, race lines, because it's people getting together for their communities. And I think another, maybe more at a different level, this program also helps young people have agency in their community. And I think one thing about gentrification is that it seems that things change happens in a neighborhood, and sometimes it's not clear why.
Right.
Or it's not always clear that it doesn't have to happen in the way that it seems almost inevitable in many communities to be happening.
Right.
So actually, like, one thing we do, which was mentioned when you were talking about the brochure, is to identify the different forces in our environments. So to ask questions like, why was this building bought, and why can we no longer live there? Or why did it used to look like this and it now looks like this? Because it's not just some thing that happened. There's no real answer except for having to do with something you can't understand, but we can understand it.
Yeah.
So I think that the power, and not only understand, but also address it. So the idea of agency is very critical, I think.
And when you say agency, what do you mean by agency? How do you mean that term?
I I guess I see it as like one's ability to affect change or to mm-hmm. feel that they have purpose where they live and can do something right. about a challenge that has arisen.
And that to me is one of the powerful parts of the program, because you know, how many people are looking at 11 to 14 year olds? How many people look at you as agents for change for the community? How many approach you and say, you know, you can change the community, and not having to wait till you're adults to do it? And I think that's partly the spiritual empowerment part of knowing who we are, but then also one of the parts of the program that you talk about is the power of expression. Can you talk a little bit about that? Is helping young people with their power of expression. Can you share? Why don't you share a little bit about that?
Yeah. So, I guess the power of expression. We all know it's important to communicate with people, and so this power of expression, especially with young people, is very important in being able to express their needs, their wants, or how they're feeling. And so this ability to really be able to clearly express their understandings of their community, what they feel is needed within their community, how these things are making them feel, will then be easy to allow other people to understand these things and hopefully be able to consult together and talk with each other about how these things can be addressed and how these things can actually make some change in the community.
And you know, it's a very powerful thing. Sometimes, you know, this concept, power of expression, can be like, when you think about all the problems that exist out there, some people can say, well, why are you talking about the powers of expression? But you know, how can you solve any problem unless you really know how to express yourself, know how to analyze it, know how to talk about it, but also know how to talk about it really with a spiritual consciousness and mindset. Mm-hmm. So you're not just falling into the same traps of the conflict that we see when people talk about things all the time, but you're learning mm-hmm. the skills of talking, solving conflict, resolving conflict. And I know that one of the books deals with confirmation. I mean, that's a subtle thing, but anybody who has any religious background or affiliation at all knows that if they try to align themselves with a higher purpose and they try to stay on that path, that they receive confirmations. But who's teaching our kids to recognize the power of that and the energy around that? And that's part of how life goes, is that as you align yourself with a higher spiritual purpose and you try to live that regardless, you get confirmations. And to help young people have that as a part of their identity and a part of the reality of their life as they go into high school and beyond, that's very powerful. I think it's a very powerful part of the program. And the other, another thing I want to ask you all, and again, not putting you on the spot, but just thinking of the time you have been in it, Brianna, just any ways it's helped you, any ways you feel like the program's helped you, changed you, made you think differently, however you want to respond to that.
I guess it helped me just kind of be more an insightful person, mm-hmm. or maybe just a better person, period. Because like last year we did a bake sale and then we made bag lunches for the homeless people around mm-hmm. our community. Mm-hmm. And that just helped me think about like how good I felt not just helping, period, and not having to have anything in return, but the weight lift off my shoulder that I actually helped someone. Mm-hmm.
I like what you said, without having anything in return, except for that good feeling, right? And you can't replace that good feeling in your heart when you do something for somebody for no other reason but that you care about them. And I want to ask you, Mommy, how have you seen it help your daughter? How have you seen the program help your daughter?
I've seen her be enthusiastic about upcoming projects, about being involved, about being with her peers, being involved, and the significance and the importance, and that smile and her whole demeanor, that's, you know, rewarding.
Yeah. Absolutely. As a mother, it's gotta feel good to know that your child is in a place and in a space that's only doing good. You know?
Yes, it's just maintaining, because yeah. as they grow, things change, you know, friends change, environments change, so I just encourage it like every day. They encourage it weekly. I encourage it daily because right. it takes a village of encouragement.
Absolutely. 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 What a great preparation for high school and beyond. You know, I was going to ask Rashad a couple of questions, but I'll just ask you all, just in terms of the animators themselves. Mm-hmm. Well, okay, so we'll start with the animators. Those who have been the mentors for the young folks, they're high school and beyond. Is that primarily mm-hmm. who does it?
Yeah.
And what kinds of, I don't want to say success stories because that seems too trite, but what have you seen, kind of some of the transformation that's taken place with some of the animators? I know Rashad's one, but just in general, you don't have to name any names, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Either one of you.
I think one thing that we've seen as we're working with more animators is their own sense of involvement in their community and how they see possibilities around them. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about how we can help to support our communities in different ways, they, because of their involvement, I think that they see many ideas around them. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, we should go and meet these people. This person might need help. We could plan this. And I think that kind of like sense of one's place in their community, which is a place of service to others,
mm-hmm.
It starts, I mean, we hope with animating that, that's kind of one place where it finds expression, but mm-hmm. actually that it's part of your everyday life all mm-hmm. the time.
Right.
They are always coming from a place of service to others. So that has been really wonderful yeah. to see, and just to kind of, we're like shoulder to shoulder with everyone, right. with all of the animators, with all of the participants in the program. We're all here kind of for the same aim.
And you all really have dedicated a lot of time. I mean, you're both doing this full time, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, so that is quite a tribute to both of you to serve the community full time. So something must have animated you as well. And so your experience of what you've seen in terms of, again, the development of young people, of the junior youth, what kinds of things and changes and developments have you seen? You know, how has that helped them? Have you seen, it's a 3-year program, and I should mention that. Mm-hmm. It's from 11 to 14. The ideal is that people go through the 3 years and then hopefully want to become animators themselves. That's, I think, a goal, mm-hmm. if possible. But just what are some of the changes you've seen in some of these junior youth in your time?
I think I've seen the junior youth be able to as we've been talking about, take on more ownership and, like, when they have an idea, to really express it and share it and want to see how that idea can possibly be put into action. And just like you were mentioning, many of the junior youth have also, like, through their learnings and maybe some challenges that they see even within the group, because they have, at least from my perspective, it seems they have this desire to really ensure that the group is working together in this collaborative spirit. Many of the junior youth themselves have also expressed like, oh, like this is something that maybe is not working, but when I become a high schooler, when I turn 15, like I want to be an animator, like I'm going to do this yeah. and I'm going to become an animator. So it's been very cool to see them also take on ownership and see that they really are able to make a difference.
And believing in them, you know, it's as you were both expressing what you were expressing, the thing that came to my mind was purpose.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you're out there without a purpose, then you're just going to wander. But if you have a sense of purpose that's really aligned with something in you that you know is good, and you feel like, again, like you were saying, the purpose for that day was, you know, you wanted to do something for homeless people. You feel a purpose of your life is service, and that was how you directed it. And then the confirmation of feeling good came to you. And I think when young people start to feel that power, that's a unique kind of power, and that's something people can't take from you. Nobody can take that from you. And I think that program, and I think a lot about purpose, because I think a lot of the challenges with our young people is they lack purpose and they lack hope. And they lack a place to express that purpose that is wholesome and healthy. So that some of the things you were saying really, really touched me. And you know, obviously, my concerns for all the community, but I get concerned about the young black men out there because of the many things that are happening to them, the challenges that they face. You know, we know about the police shootings, but there's all other challenges that they face too. And having, like I know Rashad has got such a powerful demeanor and expression and a commitment to service. And, you know, and so he's trying to, quote, go on the path, I think, that's gonna be reinforcing for him and his neighborhood. And I'm sure this program's had a huge impact on that. Probably he was a good kid already anyway, and he just developed even more with that, from strength to strength, like you're saying. And I think this is important. Like, we see, like in these young people right here, like you can look at them and you can see the gems in them. You can see the heaven in their face. You can see the capacity in their face. You can feel it as they smile, as they look. And then for people to take that and say, let's channel that before they get caught up in other kinds of groups, right? Which is so easy to do, because everybody wants to belong to a group. I mean, that's just generally true. Nobody likes to be isolated and out there by themselves. So, you know, you talk about some of the activities that you do. You know, we've talked about the program in general. We've talked about the impact of the program. But within the context of the actual classes or the gatherings themselves, what kinds of things do you do to help create this sense of empowerment?
So during the groups, there, well, I can just share kind of what happens in many of the groups, right, which is that we study these books together. And Todd mentioned one earlier, the first one, that had the theme of confirmation, which is kind of like, if you try hard, doors will open for you. Mm-hmm. So these books are very focused on these themes that are universal across all cultures and faiths, mm-hmm. but that help anyone, really. I find myself always drawing on the themes from these books to think about their purpose in life, the choices they make, how they relate to other people. So there's the study, there's service projects, which is a huge component, as we've heard, which is self-directed by the middle schoolers, which is also kind of a unique part of the program, where we don't have a ready-made list of things for the junior youth to do, but they see in their environment what they like to do to help it. And then we have different kinds of recreation and arts. And so in addition to this, we often, I mean, we try to include the participants of the program in many neighborhood activities, because mm-hmm. there's more than just activities for the middle schoolers. Mm-hmm. But one of the goals is also that, you know, the junior youth are, even at that kind of young age of 11 to 14, they're helping younger kids. Younger than them, their siblings, their friends, right, their neighbors. And so the idea of those always helping those younger than them, mm-hmm. is we try to carry it through many aspects of this program.
You know, there's several things you said, what you said and what you kind of implied. I think, you know, a lot of times these programs, you know, programs that serve neighborhoods can be seen as imposing. People are trying to impose their values or their will, or to come into a neighborhood and, quote, save the neighborhood. But what you have been talking about this whole time is not about saving the neighborhood, but about how the people themselves decide everything it is about what they want to do within their own neighborhood, and which is a very difficult and challenging thing to do in any kind of development project. A lot of times, any kind of development projects, the people who come in kind of supersede the residents themselves and say, well, you know, I think you really need to do this, and this is how you need to change it, this is what you need to do in your neighborhood. But to empower, to work side by side with people and say, let's learn together, you kind of help decide what it is you think needs to be done, and then we'll do this together. That's a very subtle thing, but a very profound and important thing. And I think that speaks to the premise of oneness, that we're all one and we all have these capacities, and we can't just assume some have the capacities and some don't, but that we all do. And it's about mining those gems, if you will, that everybody has. So, I mean, I was feeling that and hearing that, because I've been sensitive to that all my life, you know, because I've seen it so many times. Are they part of there's another program?
Mm-hmm.
You're another program. Okay, I just want to make sure you weren't supposed to be on this program. I'm sorry, welcome. Good to see you all. So where are they? Okay, junior youth programs, where are they in D.C.? Where they exist in D.C.?
So in D.C., right now there are 17 groups that meet around the city, and okay. primarily a lot of the groups right now are in Columbia Heights and a few other neighborhoods, Petworth, Shaw, and there are a couple of groups in Northeast near Brooklyn and Edgewood, and we're right now there are also a few groups in Southeast, but we're trying to become really more evenly distributed across the city.
Yeah, yeah. But you're coming to our neighborhood across the river soon.
Yeah. Because it's really, the goal is that this program is offered for every middle schooler in the city.
Right.
But that is also, I'm glad we talk a lot about animating, because we couldn't have the program without committed animators.
Okay, we got somebody online. Who's online? Who's on the phone? Hello?
Hey,
Oh, yeah, that's him. Rashad, are you there? We're gonna try to pipe you in, Rashad. We're trying to get you. I don't know what's happening. Well, if you're listening, call back because we're.
What? He said he can't hear us. I guess.
Can't
hear us. He can't hear us. Okay, so Rashad can't hear us, so I tell you what, to have him call you, have him call your phone, and we'll just get a little bit from him, because I really want to hear just a little bit about his experiences, even if we have to translate it for the rest of the audience. And so, Maddie, you were talking about the places, but this mm-hmm. program really exists worldwide,
mm-hmm.
and I think that's an important, and if you can just briefly just mention, and this is part of a broader community building process. This is one element of a broader community building process. And if you can just share just a little bit about kind of that vision, because
mm-hmm.
because I think Rashad's calling in.
Yes.
Yay, verily.
Hello. Okay, hold on one second.
Hey, Rashad, we're putting you on speaker. Can you hear us? We can probably hear you too. So I'm gonna put you right up to the microphone. And hope you pick up. So just kind of talk a little bit loud, okay?
Put that in the headphone.
Okay.
Put that in the headphone on the phone.
Okay, we gotta do a little technical thing here, Rashad. Hold on a second.
Okay.
Okay, you still there, brother?
Yes, sir.
All right, Rashad. We have just a few minutes left, and so I just want to ask you a couple questions and just respond as you will. But first of all, what initially attracted you to being an animator? We've already talked about what all that means, but what initially attracted you to being an animator for this program?
Around my community. That's really it.
And so, lots of programs that do that, but what was it about this program?
So, other programs might, you can help the poor and, maybe just do some other things, but this program helps change a kid's perspective in life. Instead of them making them believe in something that's not going to help them through life, you're making them believe in something that's going to make them a different person.
That's powerful, Rashad. And so in your animating, how has it helped you to grow as a person?
I mean, I say a lot, honestly. At first I'm not really the type to be very open to a lot of people, especially to young kids that are younger than me, because I feel like they're very annoying. But now as I grow up and I grew up with them, because I feel like they grew up with me. I feel like a different person. I can deal with any type of age group successfully. So they motivate me in a sense.
Well, that's fine. Motivation is very powerful, and desire to work with young people to help you to develop a desire to work with young people, which you've always cared about, but now you really want to do it, and you are doing it. And so you were in South Carolina, or you were in D.C. How long were you an animator?
1 year.
1 year, and now you're where?
In Arizona.
And you're doing what in Arizona?
I'm attending University of Arizona.
Praise God.
Business and marketing.
All right. Study. You said University of Arizona?
Yes.
Studying business and marketing. Have you been able to connect out there at all to any of the programs? Have you been able to connect to any of the junior youth or junior youth programs out there at all?
Yes. One of the animators that was with us in D.C., her name is Nicole. She reached out to her mother and told her mother about me and my brother Charles and wanted us to attend the animated group in Arizona, in Tucson specifically. So we went to their group for the first time last week when I'm thinking, and it was nice. It was very open. It was like a lot of open people who we had stories to talk about, and I like it.
All right, good. So you're translating what you learned here out there in that warm climate. Are you loving that climate?
Oh, yes, I do every day.
So you better get a big house because we're going to come and join you in about a month when it gets cold up here.
Of course. I have an open room for you if you want to.
Okay, hey. All right, Rayshawn. Listen, Rayshawn, we're about running out of time here. We just got a couple minutes left, so I'm going to have to sign off with you. But thank you so much for calling in. Did you have any other last things you wanted to say about the program, about your experiences, or are we good?
I mean, really, honestly, if you don't join the Baha'i, just ask yourself why. Like, that's really it. Then I'm just going to tell you. Then, yeah, please, we need more animators. Please join us. I mean, yeah, the experience is something you cannot get from nowhere else. That's really it. So, yeah, thank you.
Powerful, Rayshawn. Powerful. I didn't get you over. What were you going to do before you left? I forgot, but I know I didn't get it done. Whatever it was we were going to do. We were going to do something.
I was supposed to battle this kid in Connect Four.
Connect Four. We missed out on Connect Four before you left, brother. Okay, well, when you come back, we'll do that. But what you just said about becoming part of this program because it's so special, I hope everybody heard that, because it's not just about touting the program. It's about the fact that there's some serious issues going on in our community, and if there's a program that can really help that and that people can testify that it helps transform people, then I think, you know, we need, whoever's hearing this needs to check it out. So thanks for sharing that piece of information. So we're going to sign off with you, brother. Enjoy, study hard, and thanks for calling in.
All right. Okay.
Well, everybody, we got to wind down. It's just 7 o'clock now. I want to thank my guests. I want to thank Bianca. I want to thank Brianna. I want to thank Ebony. I want to thank Maddie. I want to thank Crystal, all for being here. You all are the hope of the future. And I want to say thank you again to Brother Reggie and everybody who supported me in this room. I appreciate it very much. And maybe I'll see you another time. Thank you. Meanwhile, see the heaven in every black face.